So, in all seriousness, how should your day go? So let's take you through a day. Okay, so welcome everyone, all friends here, those who are dedicated to really a lifetime of boosting your mental health, a lifetime of boosting your mental health, going towards perfect mental health. When we get up in the morning, ideally, we need to first focus on the wow for the day, saying, "I am going to be wowed today like I've never been wowed before. I'm going to meet Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma today, or I'm going to meet Jesus Christ today. I'm going to meet one of the Dharma kings today." Put it like that. It's going to be that great of a day. Today is your day, and so you must say, "Wow, I've got to get my mind ready so when it happens, I'm able to prevent myself from going into panic." This is how to start every single day, and I try to do that every single day. And this primes the pump, so to speak. It primes the spiritual pump that pumps up the spiritual insight for you, clarity for you, because you're prepared to handle it. Now, you may not meet Jesus today, but you might get close to meeting Jesus, or a lot closer, actually. And in fact, when you do this practice like this, you do get a lot closer. You really do. I continually am getting closer and closer and closer. Just prior to this taping, many, many, many insights are flowing. Not that I can really remember them. I'm not trying to remember them, because what's more important than remembering any particular insight, for our purposes here, is to explain how to get those insights in your life, which is to put yourself in this mode of receptivity, meaning you're prepared to handle the shock of it all. The shock of it all, because it most certainly is going to shock you, because you don't quite expect yourself to be so brilliant. You can say, "I didn't know I was so brilliant. This is quite a shocker." I mean, we live in a spiritual ghetto. This world is nothing but a really, really terrible spiritual ghetto. And you know, the ghetto mentality is, it's really difficult to get out of there, because every time you try to get out of there, everybody says, you're a turncoat, you're a traitor, you can't leave the hood. Come on, what are you doing? I mean, what do you think, you're too good for us or something? So it's super difficult to leave, and if you do leave, you know, they're done with you, basically. And that's how this world is. It's a spiritual ghetto. And so everybody thinks that they're really, you know, born dumb and will die dumb, and there's nothing anybody can do about it except take drugs and sex, drugs, and rock and roll. And that's pretty much it. That's all you can do about it. And so this is when you suddenly great clarity arises in you. It's like, what happened? Yeah, this isn't supposed to happen. You know, I hope nobody, none of my fellow ghettoites know about this, right? It's a cult, this world. It really is. It's a cult of super impoverished spiritual clarity. Super impoverished spiritual clarity. People wear it proud. They're proud. So I'm proud to be a, you know, impoverished, spiritually impoverished, mentally ill, mentally confused, arrogant, fearful, you know, all this depressed person, and because I'm treating it with all these medications and various things, and I'm not gonna bend to anything else. I'm gonna stick it out, and so they're, you know, kind of proud to suffer, proud sufferers, you might call this world, very proud sufferers. So when you come in and suggest, you know, "Hey, you can actually get free of suffering," they say, "What? You know, no, I don't need analysis. I don't need help. I don't need. I am suffering, and I can take it. And I've got a lot of drugs that are going to help me get through my suffering. We've been clever enough to invent these drugs, and by golly, I'm going to use them." I said, "Well, how about getting free of the suffering in the first place?" No. That's nothing we can do about that." Well, there is something we can do about it, but as long as we don't know how to deal with the shock of realizing, hey, we can do something about it, which comes as a revelation to us here, it really does, then we'll continue. We'll just slide right back into the trouble. A friend of mine today expressed that he had something really bad happen to him. I didn't press him what it was, because I don't need to know what it was. The advice is the same whether he explains it to me or not. And what good is explaining to it? It doesn't. I didn't ask him. And it's the first time I've ever done something like that. I think it's really wise. He just told me that something out of the blue, just really, really catastrophic, really terrible happened in his life. And I said, okay, all right. So, and I just sort of, you know, said, I'm sorry that you know, you're going through this, and I understand that these things are happening now. It's not totally surprising that something really surprising would happen right now. I was able to kind of help his confidence. I said, well, I went through something really tough yesterday. I feel a lot better today. And so you'll bounce back, and I know you will. And so I stayed really confident for him, really, really confident. And this is what's helpful in the world, is that as bad as the tragedy that hit him today was, it's even more shocking when we see we can be free of tragedy. That's more shocking than tragedy. We're so used to tragedy. Everybody has a tragedy. You talk to anybody. A friend of mine, also the day before, it was amazing for my friends yesterday. He his truck, his brakes, he went off a hill, when his brakes failed, and he had to jump out of this truck, save his life. He was on a hill trying to do something, and the brakes didn't hold or something. But it was, you know, he had to jump for his life out of it. And so, fortunately, he's relatively okay. I think he hurt his knee or something. But back kind of quite a day. But everyone I talk to is like, seems to be suffering from this and this and this and this and this, and wow. And so it's great to have somebody who's not suffering, who's feeling confident, say, look, you're gonna bounce back from this. I know you will. I know you will. I'm waiting for you, and I'll be there for you when you bounce back. It gives them something to look forward to see that it isn't all doom and gloom. So it's really, really helpful to have the Dharma Kings on our side, because nothing gets them down. They say, you know, I know you're suffering, but we feel perfect. We feel perfect, and you will too. You will too soon. So that's great to hear that. Really great to hear that. But we're so used to tragedy in the news surrounding us. When's the last time you heard someone say, you know what, today I just realized that there's definitely a way to be free of all suffering and misery forever. And I got a very clear look at it. And I know that it's very doable, and we're getting real close. How often do you hear that? Maybe only here do you hear this. But you certainly don't hear it very often, do you? It's rarer than rare. It's the rarest of rare here in the world. So when you internally get this recognition, you're just bowled over by it. Absolutely bowled over by it. If you're like a teenager and you're unpopular, and let's say there's the queen of the high school, you know, the prom queen, or the prom king. And everybody thinks, oh, they're just like unreachable. They're so amazing, you know. It's just, and then you go to school one day, and the prom queen or the prom queen or prom king, comes up and says, hi. He says, I'd like to ask you to the prom. I want you to go to the prom with me. You know, it's like, me? I remember, like in high school, I was like super unpopular. So much so nobody even knew who I was, and. Really, nobody knew who I was. And so I go around and say, I hope somebody, you know, knows who I am here. And nobody really cares who I am in the slightest bit. And imagine if the prom queen had come and said, you know what, I want you to go to the prom with me. If you'll accept, it'd be an honor. It'd be a great honor for me if you went to the prom with me. And just like, I'd freeze up. I would have frozen up. I'd have been speechless. I'd have been freaked out. So, you know, when we're miserable, and the idea of something really amazing happening, where we're elevated in the eyes of the world, so to speak, or in our own eyes, is shocking. It's very shocking. And it's taken me, you know, it takes a long time. The interaction I've had with the Dharma Kings, you're interacting with me? I mean, are you kidding me? Nobody even knows who I am. How do you know who I am? How do you know? Why are you interacting with me? Well, the world wasn't interested in what I had to say, but the Dharma Kings certainly really are very pleased that I'm sharing their ideas with the world. But keep in mind that the really positive, that really elevates you, that's so rare, it will freak you out. So what you have to do is you have to just basically say, today I know I'm going to be freaked out, but I know there's a way to prevent that from turning into panic. So I'm going to put myself in this wow mode, like I expect to be wowed. So when I'm wowed, I say, well, everything's fine. I expected to be wowed today. I expected to be wowed. Something is going to wow me today. It may not be the prom queen or prom king asking you out, because you may be, but something like that, you know, something that just says, that just tells you that, you know, you are absolutely extraordinary, actually. We all are. We all are. We have a ghetto complex, though. And when we find out that we are absolutely extraordinary, we tend to, you know, go hide under a rock. Say, leave me alone, leave me alone. I'm not ready for this. I'm not ready for prime time. Well, who is here in the world? Who's ready for prime time? Doesn't seem like anyone's ready for prime time here. But we are prime time, all of us. So we can run and hide, but we can never escape the fact of what we are, which is we're totally extraordinary. We're perfect. We're all creativity, really. We absolutely are the creativity of God. We absolutely are the creativity of God. That's what we are. God shared all creativity, and that sharing of all creativity is what we are. So we're one with the flow. We're one with the one flow of all creativity. Spontaneity, absolute spontaneity, to an extent that all directions simultaneously, a dance of spontaneity in all directions simultaneously, you know, 360 degree spontaneity. So when we even get a little glimpse of this, it's like, wow, I'm way better than this world has even remotely even imagined. There's nothing in this world that really even touches on what we are, actually. There really isn't. As Jesus says, there's nothing in this world that tells you anything about what you are. Okay. Obviously, he's excluding himself, the speaker, and the Dharma kings, those who know this is a fact. They're informing you of a fact. Okay. So there's nothing in this world that tells you what you are. It tells you anything about what you are. Nothing in the natural world that tells you anything about what you are. Nothing that takes place in this world, so to speak, other than being informed of this fact and informed of the truth of what you are. But only those who have overcome the world thinking that know that it doesn't tell them anything about what they are able to inform us properly. And then some can pass on this information and help reinforce it. Jesus calls these teachers of God. But what we do is we keep, you know, bringing this up and presenting it so others can hear it and consider it and also speak of it down the road. I was thinking about this today. I was thinking how fortunate I was to have a Dharmic dad. I was talking with someone about my life and talking about my dad, and I thought about it. I remember, I said, you know, who was so fortunate? Who else was so fortunate? I mean, we were the most unusual. He was the most unusual dad anyone had in school, for sure. I mean, no television, you know, popular culture was not really allowed in our house. No drugs, you know, no pills, none of that stuff. No drinking, no smoking, no swearing. I mean, it was very strict, wonderful Dharmic upbringing. How fortunate to have that in the Western world, right? But I said, well, who do I have to thank? I said, I thank him. I said, well, wait a minute. But it's not just him. It's all his previous lives and all the contact that he had in those previous lives with others that were Dharmic that schooled him. Someone schooled him on all that. I'm sure he was an Indian, a sadhu or yogi in India in his previous life, because that's where he went back to and he felt at home there. And all his habits were very much that way. I mean, he was a hatha yogin. He was so completely yogic. So, for sure, he probably had many, many lives in India, and many, many teachers, and the influence of all these great gurus in India had brought about a Dharmic culture to such an extent that he was able to absorb that, you see, and then pass it on to me. So, really, it's, you know, the great Indian gurus have had a lot to do with what I am, you know, because of my upbringing. And keep in mind that Buddhism also arose in India, and that greatly contributed to the overall dharmic flavor of that whole subcontinent area. Okay, and that is just, it's just, you know, it sort of permeated the combination of everything that's taken place there, permeates the whole area, and he somehow he had been able to really, really get it really got into him, and he was, that was all he was interested in life, you know, what was liberations, enlightenment, and what he called it, progressing his consciousness, which is dualistic. So he hadn't yet made the jump into non-dual recognition, but the discipline and the focus and determination, everything, and the realization of building a strong base foundation was all there. So I had that growing up in a very decadent place, actually. So it's a very, very rare situation. And so I have him to thank, and yet maybe, you know, countless thousands and maybe millions to thank. That we, every drop of Dharma in the world adds up to a mighty, mighty river and a mighty ocean. And an ocean of Dharma comes from the effort of every single one of us doing the best we can to spread the Dharma, spread the truth here in this world or wherever we find ourselves. And that contributes to the overall, the ocean of Dharma, which then everyone can bathe in, right? It's the bigger the lake, the more that we can bathe in it, the bigger the ocean, the more that we can sail upon it and immerse ourselves in it. But he felt, you know, he was fighting a, you know, quite a battle, and he couldn't take it anymore here in the West, in California. He had to go back to India. He couldn't take it. It was so non-dharmic here. He couldn't take it anymore. I mean, he tried the Bay Area during the 60s and 70s, tried to be hip, but overall, it was still so non-dharmic, really. He was serious. He was very serious about it. And he went back to India, and he felt he was trying to reconnect, you know, with the real serious intent. And he didn't quite find it. Didn't quite find it. And ultimately, he just told me, you know, I just don't like this place anymore. The whole vibe here is just, I don't feel like I belong, you know, I just don't belong here. Very interesting. But this just goes to show that the influence of all those who have really helped out. I'm indebted to all of them. I'm indebted to the whole history of spiritual endeavor on this planet. Very much indebted to it. And we all are, to the extent that we're making headway. It doesn't just, it didn't just arrive yesterday. Although we are, and to pay back the gratitude is to advance it, which is what we're doing here. So I'm thrilled that we're able to add, you know, even greater clarity to it all, which is what I've been trying to do in my life, is I want to really make the non-dual teaching even clearer, really, really help as many as possible get past some of the objections they have. We all have styles that differ, and we're all unique, so no one style can please everybody, and no matter what style it is, nobody's going to quite resonate with it the same way that I might. Not quite, no, it's not possible. So that's always going to be difficult, but you still have to resonate with it as much as possible and then have your own insights arise. And the best way to have your own insights arise is to prepare yourself every day in the morning to be wowed by your own clarity. The external guru comes and goes. I mean, right? Yeah, where's Jesus? Where's Sri Sri Ananda Maimon? Where's Rama Maharshi? I wish we could go see them somewhere right now. But so whoever you meet in the world, they come and they go. You have to go. They may have to leave. You know, eventually they get old and pass away. You do it. But the inner guru stays with you constantly, permanently, never leaves you. So the gurus say that what they're really doing is they're just turning you, pulling you, attracting you inward to the inner guru. And the inner guru is the real guru, because that one stays with you all the time. So if for instance, I was given a vision, a guru vision of intrinsic spaciousness by being with Longchenpa in a dream, I woke the next morning and I just suddenly realized intrinsic spaciousness. I said, wow, I'd never even considered this before. It was brand new. And I just said, what is this? This is it. I said, well, this is it. Obviously, this is it. So this is what the gurus are pointing at. I said, oh, of course it is. I said, but it's so simple. In fact, it's totally simple. Yeah. and so it's so simple, there's no way to it, really. There's no way to it. Just is. This is obvious. It's totally obvious. Any thinking about it blinds you to it. Really, it's totally obvious. But then it wore off. Okay. Whereas if the inner guru appears to you and just stays with you continuously, the formless inner guru. This recognition of intrinsic spaciousness may very well just stay with you. Maybe very well just stay with you. And you don't know how it arrives or how it's staying with you, except it's what it just does. So at some point we have to practice saying that I don't know how it arrived. I don't know why it's here. I don't know how it is that it's staying. I have no answers at all for this. It just is. That's all I can say. So this is kind of the wisdom I got just before taping, is we can practice saying, I have no clue. I don't have a clue. Why? What happened was I was sitting at my desk, and suddenly I felt this feeling. And I said, ah, that's it. And I said, that's the groove. I want to stay in this groove. And I said, well, where did it come from? And I said, right away I said, let's practice. I don't know where it came from. Okay, I don't know how it got here. I don't have really any answers at all about it. That's the best I can do. Practice that. In other words, no attempt to even dissect it at all. No attempt to put yourself in a subject-object position, a dualistic position in regard to it. How is this happening to me, or why? You know, put it out there and examine it. You just say, I don't know. I don't know. I don't know why. I don't know how. I don't know why it happened to me, why it happened now. I have no idea why it happened now. How did I manage to get this? I have no clue. I'm absolutely clueless. Just out of the blue. It just happened out of the blue. I have no answers for you. Maybe my friend was giving me some help today. He said, just out of the blue, this something happened. It's just something just, for him, that was disastrous. But he emphasized, it just came out of the blue, out of nowhere. I had no foreknowledge of it. No, it just, there it was. Now, I interpret that, though, in a positive way. I try to interpret everything in a positive way, even the catastrophes that people tell me about. Who's to say that they aren't pointing something out very, very important to you? And I did see myself in a dream a couple nights ago, all dressed in blue. I changed my dressing style, and I was wearing all blue, and I said, huh, can I wear this in the world? I was thinking, I said, maybe I can get used to it. I think I'm going to switch over to all blue. And I'm wearing all blue right now, as a matter of fact. blue, sky-like, you know, vision, guru vision has been referred to as sky-like. Intrinsic spaciousness is the sky-like vision. This is what Longchenpa calls it, and blue is the symbol of the sky. So, in this dream, I switched my wardrobe over to all blue, meaning I switched my perspective over to intrinsic spaciousness. And then I was thinking, well, can I wear this? And I said, well, yeah, I can wear this. I had bare feet also. Interesting. But I don't know why I changed. I don't know why I changed. I don't know how it happened. It just came out of the blue, and I don't know if it'll leave me or stay with me or leave me. I have no clue about any timetable or structure or anything about it. I really don't see any structure to it at all, as a matter of fact. I can't discern any structure to it at all. But, you know, it's here. There's nothing I can do about it. You know, I don't really feel like doing anything, trying to do anything about it, because there's no structure. How can I judge what to do about it? I'm not able to determine, you know, any parameters at all, actually. So, you know, just, but I feel that it's beneficial for everyone, so I'll just put up with not having any answers for now, right? So this is the attitude. Just say, well, something has arrived, which is obviously extraordinarily beneficial, and I don't have any answers in regard to it at all, and I may never have any answers, but that's okay, because out of compassion for the world, it just happened. And, you know, I can't figure it out. I'm not going to even try. There's nothing to figure. I can't even get started on any figuring. I'm not good at figuring anyway. So yeah, out of the blue, just wow, just like that. I don't expect something catastrophically bad to happen to me at all. Just the opposite. I think something catastrophically wonderful is going to happen in my case. But many would interpret that as terrible. You know, so, oh my gosh, you don't have any clues why this happened? I mean, you know, that must be scary. Not knowing. I said, well, no, it's not scary. It feels really like this groove, amazing groove. Wonderful. I'm just feel totally grooved. But I don't know why I feel grooved. And you know, I really don't have any answers. So, well, you know, that's horrible. We need answers about how we feel and this and this, this and that. Well, I don't know who's feeling horrible about it. I'm certainly not. Maybe the pharmaceutical companies are feeling horrible about it. I said, we got to know the chemistry of it. We got to know what caused it. We got to, you know, we can't just have this happening out of the blue. But I don't have any clue. It came out of the blue, and I don't have a clue. I don't have a clue. Can't break it down for you. So we can practice that, actually. What a lovely evening. It's about 8:30 here, and we're outside, as always. And there's this lovely breeze, and it was about, I think it got up to 90 degrees today. But supposedly, we're supposed to have a heat wave, supposedly. You know, the weather forecasting these days is not so great. But they're expecting it to get pretty toasty, especially in the Southlands, Southwest for sure. But we'll see. They might be hyping it quite a bit. But it does look like it's going to warm up here, you know, low to mid-90s. Perhaps some days may touch the high 90s. It's going to be a stretch of maybe 8 to 10 days. So it's a pretty good heat spell. We're going to feel it. But it's nice to feel this sort of cool breeze here. Very nice to feel this cool breeze. I don't know where the breeze came from, right? Came out of the blue. But do you ever have that happen where you just suddenly feel this groove, and it feels like something you felt long, long, long time ago? And at first I thought maybe I felt this earlier in my lifetime. And I thought, but when I felt it earlier in my lifetime, it seemed ancient back then. So maybe it's something much more ancient than just this earlier years of this life. And maybe it goes back to other lives, or maybe it's even more ancient than that. It felt like some very ancient, super ancient groove that I could not really account for. I really couldn't account for it. And I said, well, you're welcome to hang out here in this age. You know, why not? We're so advanced now, we should be hospitable, right? I mean, shouldn't we have great hospitality? I mean, isn't everybody very hospitable to one another these days? Yeah. Some people are beyond the nonsense, you know? A lot of us are actually beyond the nonsense. It's sort of the vocal minority who's really stirring up, constantly has to stir up the nonsense for the media and for the pharmaceutical companies to make sure we all stay agitated and sick. But most of us really, we're kind of beyond the nonsense. Yeah, it's just, okay, well, that's nice entertainment, but, you know, I think we want something, you know, better than that. Come on. So something like an ancient groove. Wow. This ancient groove came upon me. And I can't even delineate it in any way. It's so ancient, I cannot even put it into any context whatsoever. It's futile. It's futile. And yet it's there. So you can practice this. Don't just think it's some talk I'm giving. What I give out is practice. This is not theory. This is practice. Practice wowing this. Say, wow, when I get up this morning, wow, an ancient groove is going to come upon me today. Wow. And I can't put it into any context whatsoever. Wow. Okay? So prepare for this. It's kind of right, like reverse induction. We're giving up trying to induce abnormality, and so it seems like we're inducing normality, but it's really we're giving up trying to induce abnormality, but it may for a while feel like we're inducing this by our practice. But it's kind of like reverse induction, actually. But don't worry, one way or the other, we need to practice it. But I don't know what I'm going to do in life, but maybe this is it. Some super ancient groove will just come upon me. I'm pretty groovy, so I might be able to handle it. Might be able to handle a super ancient groove. Super ancient. So much so, again, I just couldn't feel any context to it, really. It just seemed timeless. Some groove that's so ancient, it feels almost timeless. You can't really put any time context on it, even though you assume it has one, but you really can't discern what it might be. It's like that. Okay? So really, we're right with it right now. Okay? We're right here, right now, absolutely with the most advanced teaching probably in the world here, in that we're actually able to recognize the wisdom of actually practicing, wowing beforehand our reaction to this groove that's so ancient that we can't even discern any time context about it, and yet we assume it has one. It's just we can't discern it at all, and there's really no point in even trying, actually. But we allow the assumption to be there, but it doesn't affect the groove at all. Doesn't affect the groove at all. So we're get up in the morning, wow, that this some ancient groove is going to come upon you today, out of the blue. It came upon me out of the blue, absolutely. I was just sitting in front of the computer wondering what to do, and just from nowhere, I suddenly felt this groove. And I said, wow, I want that. I want to stay in that groove. I love this groove. Wow. But then I said, well, I can't discern what it is. And then I immediately said, let's just wow it. Just wow it. Don't try to define it or anything. I can't define it. There's nothing discernible. There's no discernible context to define. But hey, it is what it is. Just go with it. Why not? Just go with it. The Summer of 17 groove. So you might think, well, what can I do? Well, you can practice as if this is going to happen. This is the way to do it. Practice as if it's going to come upon you. Don't wait for it and hope on it. Practice. Wow. Like, wow, an ancient groove has come upon me today. Like that when you get in the morning. Wow, this extraordinarily ancient groove has come upon me today. And it's just staying like a beautiful cloud, like an atmosphere, like a beautiful cloudy sky in some way. And you just think, oh, that just, it brings back memories, such ancient feeling and memories. I don't even know how to express it or discern a time space process form context. It seems to have one, but I really, it's just not coming into focus at all, and yet the groove is very clear. Amazing. And I'll tell you, we need that groove. Okay, I'm willing. We'll see. And if I keep practicing, why not? Just, you know, I've been jumping on the trampoline. My knee's a little sore. I maybe overdid a little bit, but and my ankles are really sore. I'm working on my ankles, actually. Ankles are a great thing to have strong, or really have strong, flexible ankles. And so I feel, you know, tired and sore. Because I've been really working out intensely. So, of course, you feel a little bit that way. And that doesn't mean that we're not getting stronger. Maybe I overdid it just a little bit. Hopefully the knee will feel better in the morning, or if not, you know, next morning, maybe the morning after that. And working out, you know, upper body, doing lower body and upper body, and I'm feeling okay. So we can do the spiritual workout every day, and we may not feel great all the time about it. But we realize we're making progress. It's very significant progress. If you're working out on a trampoline, you're going to feel pretty lousy because it hits the muscles in a way that you're not used to. But down the road, one day you'll be walking along and suddenly you'll feel like you're walking on air. And you'll say, what happened? What's going on? I'm floating. I mean, I'm just moving like a ballerina, you know? Wow. I'm just on my toes. Recently, I got up out of a seat and I got up onto my toes and I just stayed on my toes. I said, this is so easy to be on my toes. It's amazing. I'm doing a lot of trampoline jumping on my toes, actually, on my toes, trying to just right on my toes, another part of the foot, strengthening the toes. Toes are important. We tend to overlook them, right? It's the forgotten part of the body, are your toes. They're actually very, very important. So I do a lot of strength stuff with my toes. Not to mention the feet, but specifically the toes. Balancing, like balancing on your toes, really make sure you got a lot of, I mean, the toes have a lot of strength, just like our fingers have a lot of strength, but the toes also have a lot of strength. I think the people that walk those wires or ropes, slack lines, I think that they have very strong toes. They've worked on grasping with their toes. They use their toes like their hands. So it may be the practice we're doing, spiritual practice, like we've forgotten that we can practice in this way, that we can act as if we're certain that this ancient groove is going to come upon us, and so we have to prepare for that. We have to get psyched up for that. We're going to say, it's going to be wowish. I know exactly how it's going to be. It's going to be wowish. This ancient groove is going to come upon me, and I know exactly how it's going to be. It's going to be wowish. And so I'm practicing being in this wow, saying, wow, this is wow, this is wow, this is just wow, this is wow, 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 which is exact. And so your expectations then get into feeling that wow is how you're going to, you expect to feel wow. And so then once you expect to feel wow and you're comfortable with this expectation, guess what? Poof, the ancient groove arises. And you say, wow, wow. It's what the feeling is what you expect is wow. So that way you take out the shock value as much as possible. And when you take out the shock ahead of time as much as possible, guess what? It doesn't go into panic. And when you stay in the wow, when the ancient groove arises, you don't panic. Or it's, panic is greatly minimized, greatly minimized. And so if someone would come to me and ask, oh yeah, what is it? What is it? I say, well, better than asking me what it is, there's a way to prepare for it that I feel confident it will come about for you. Okay. Is to reverse induce it by expecting this wow. Expecting this wow. I just had faith that this would work and that something would arise from this effort. And then ultimately something did arise. I don't know what it is. I can't tell you what it is. But I'll tell you what, it's a fabulous groove, whatever it is. And I'm happy to stay in it. I feel very much at home in it. But I can't explain why I feel at home in it. I can't really give you any explanation about it, but I can say how I prepared for something to happen. I didn't know what would happen. I don't try to define what's going to happen, but I just practice the wow to make sure whatever happens, I just have faith that something tremendous is going to happen in my life. And I've always had that belief, very strong faith, that my life is super auspicious and something absolutely tremendous is going to take place in my life. This is the faith I came into the world with, and I've never stopped having tremendous faith in this. So I said, I better get ready for it. Whatever it is, you know, I'm going to have to get ready for it. And ready for it means that I don't panic. You know, you cannot panic and maintain it. You cannot. Because that gets you into all sorts of defenses. You try to get rid of it then to calm the panic. Nobody can just stay in panic all the time. They hate it. And so you'll try, if you're in really severe panic and you don't know how to use the wow to calm it down, calm the shock down, you'll try to get rid of what caused the panic. And if it's some arising of some amazing ancient groove, you'll try to get rid of it and you'll defend against it and it will seem to disappear on you. But I can't explain anything about it, but I can explain how to prepare for something tremendous in your life if you feel your life is truly auspicious one. So if you feel like your life is really, you know, many in the world feel that their life really is not going to amount to anything, it's not going to be vastly auspicious, and it turns out it isn't. But there are some of us who feel that their life is going to be extraordinarily auspicious. I've met some like that, you know, and So for us, we most definitely have to take it very seriously and know how to prepare for this. And as I said to kick off this video, concerning my dad and how dharmic he was, it's because of those who felt their life would be very auspicious. They prepared for it, and it became that. It did turn out that way, and they were able to then present this to the world in such a way that it helped vast numbers, and then all of that ultimately has come down to help us now, you see. So whatever we do now is going to help vast multitudes in the future. Ultimately, everyone. Ultimately, everyone. So we take this very seriously, our preparation, not knowing, we don't try to define what we're preparing for so much as to just make sure that when it arises out of the blue, you know, you say, I expect this is very wowish. I expected something extraordinarily wowish, and so that's what I expect. Wow, and I'll just stick with the wow. And I don't have anything to explain, really. I can't explain what the experience is at all. It just is. I can't explain what it is or how it is or anything about it. But it's very wowish, to say the least. So I know that those of you who realize your life is going to be very auspicious can certainly relate with what's being said here. It certainly resonates. Because we're quite attuned to getting help with our lives. It's easy to lead a life that's inauspicious because virtually everyone in the world does this. And so you're just one of the crowd. And, right? But if you're not just one of the crowd and leading an auspicious life, like I was dressed in that dream in all blue, I said, wow. This is, you know, different wardrobe than most people are wearing. I said, okay. Ah, interesting. When my friend had this trouble with the truck, someone was talking about it, and I was going to go over and start asking questions, and I did, and they ignored me, and then I walked away. I said, don't be nosy. Don't be nosy right now. Don't dig into anyone's business. And then the next day, another friend at work, they said he's in the hospital. That was today. And he got his nose all busted up, broken up. I said, oh, he was nosy, huh? He got something hit him in the nose. He was going forward. He wasn't paying attention. And then later on in the day, my friend tells me something really drastic had happened in his life. And I wasn't nosy. I was absolutely not nosy at all. I didn't ask him anything about it. Maybe this shocked him. I mean, most people in the world will say, really, what happened? I didn't ask him at all. I just looked at him. I just said, yeah, okay. I said, look, you're going to be fine. You're going to bounce back from this. There's no question about it. You're down right now, but I know you, and you bounce back. I said, go hit some golf balls. Go to the range and just smash some golf balls. And he said, you know what? That's great advice. That's really, really good advice. That sounds just right. So, you know, but I wasn't nosy at all. What happened? You know? So I've noticed that every time I try to be nosy, something jumps in my way and says, don't dig. You know, in anyone's life, don't dig. And it's preparing me perhaps to make sure that no one tries to dig into, you know, what is this groove? Don't dig. That's the wrong approach. Don't dig. Just recognize it and say, there's definitely something here. And I can feel that it doesn't seem to have any context I can put my finger on, and I'm just going to experience this, experiencing a groove without any context, at least discernible context. And I'm just going to get used to it. I'm not going to try to dig it at all. That's the way. You go to see Ramaharshi, you just sit there. In gratitude, but you just sit there. Because you're experiencing something absolute, a tremendous groove, and yet you don't know what it is. Nobody knows what it is. And yet it's still there. So, don't dig, just experience it. Get used to it. It's like a swimming pool in a hot day. Don't interrogate the swimming pool. Oh, who built you? How long have you been here? And what's the temperature? And you can ask a million questions and not get in the pool. Just get in the pool and float. Just get in the pool and float. You don't say, well, how much water is in the pool? How long did it take you to fill up the pool? Why is the pool this particular color? Does the pool always stay like this? How much cubic water is in the pool? And how high is the pool? You can really stretch questions on endlessly, 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 endlessly. And most of us are really good at doing that. Instead, just say, wow, I want to get in this pool, and you get in it. And then you say, that's the best thing I ever did. This is wonderful. That ancient groove is like a pool, a swimming pool, sort of. You just feel like, wow, I'm in this groove somehow. I'm like immersed in it, in this groove. I don't have any answers about it. I don't even have any questions about it. No questions and no answers about it. It just is. It just is. Don't even know what it is. So I can't say what it is. I can't even speculate what it is. But it is present. I'm in the groove. The groove is here. What can I say? Whatever it is, it is. And if you feel it, you feel it. It's like saying, what's causing this heat wave? Well, everything in the universe that's ever happened is causing this heat wave, actually. Can you say that there's a definite cause of anything, actually? In terms of externally, it's not a perfect analogy, actually. But that may not be the best analogy, because everything's just arising in the moment, and really nothing is causing it. In fact, nothing is being caused at all in terms of concatenation. There's never been any concatenation of causation, a chain of causation. Everything is only immediate. You can say it's uncaused, but it's not exactly true, because our desire to experience is the cause. But it's immediate. There's no chain of causation. That's a better way to put it. There's never been a chain, even one link in a chain of causation. Zero. So I'm trying to make these videos serious, because I got some feedback. One of the videos I did was a little more lighthearted, but I understand that those who are really serious, they feel that it's necessary to really get the help and practice in the right way right now. So. Uh-oh. Wow. I couldn't. That's amazing. Wasn't able to stop it. Wasn't it interesting? Well, maybe that's the ancient groove. Can't stop it. Can't stop it. Though we might practice saying, I can't stop it. There's nothing I can do to stop it. There's nothing I can do to stop it. I can't do anything at all. I can't do anything at all. Actually, we got this practice the new way. I can't do anything at all. I can't explain anything. I can't explain anything. I can't stop anything. I have no answers. I don't even have any questions. I don't have a clue. So you see how important it is to practice like this, because this allows the ancient groove to arise without any discernible context, actually, that we expect. Okay. It's really, our expectations cannot grasp it at all. So don't try to grasp. I can't grasp anything. So we practice, say, I can't grasp anything at all. There's nothing that I can grasp. I'm incapable of grasping anything. I can't discern anything. I have no discernment whatsoever. So when we practice getting our expectations in this direction, it allows this ancient groove to arise. And we say, well, that's what I expect. That's wow, yeah. I know nothing to serve. I can't do anything about it. I don't know. No answers, no questions. You say, well, yeah, that's what I already expect. I expect it to be like that, my experiencing to be like that. Nothing I can do. There's nothing I can do. We say we can't get rid of it. There's nothing I can do. I can't answer any questions about it. There's nothing I can do. There's nothing I can do. So this is the practice, the foundational practice to allowing this ancient groove to arise. Seemingly super ancient. Seemingly super ancient. Because we're putting it into a context of time, space, process, and form. So seemingly indescribably ancient, so such that we can't really discern any particulars about the context. We just feel there's a general context of time, space, process, and form, but that's as far as it goes. We can't really dig into it any further than that at all. So my friend today said he had something really catastrophic happen in his life, and I didn't ask for any more information. And since I didn't prod, he didn't give me any. And probably that may really shocked him. I did tell him. He said he felt that the world was everything is just chaos, really. It's just all chaos here. We just have to find a way to manage chaos. And I said, well, I said, yeah, it's apparent chaos. I said, but what if we're playing this game of trying to pretend to be abnormal, and that this stuff that happens, tragedy and catastrophe stuff, is just a game we're playing to try to make ourselves seem abnormal. And he heard that. He says, wow, I like that. I really like that. I see that. That's possible, isn't it? Wow. He's a very advanced being in a lot of ways. We've had a lot of sort of conversations, and he's really, you know, one of those who is much farther along than most. And so I said that. I never said to anyone socially before. I said that, He said, wow, that's amazing. He said, I can see that. I can see how that could fit, couldn't it? It could fit. It could be like that, couldn't it? And so really, it's not chaotic. We're just pretending that it is, to try to pretend that reality is abnormal, where in fact, reality, nothing happens without our deciding and desiring that it happens. So there's zero chance. There's no chaos at all in reality. Zero. But we're trying to make it seem like this stuff, you know, is chaotic. You know, it couldn't be good, whatever happened. I don't need to dig. It just obviously, he was in shock. Right? And we don't need to speculate either. It's the question now is, you know, handling the shock. Hitting some golf balls does help. Why? Because you're so lousy at it. It takes your mind off your troubles of the world. You say, doggone, I should be able to hit that ball straight. What is the matter with me? And you get really focused on, say, I'm going to do it. This time I'm going to do it. It's easy. Because I know I've done it before. And why can't I, you know, it's easy. And for an hour or so, you completely forget about your troubles, because you just have to, you're so focused on hitting that little ball straight. And it gets into you. It aggravates you such that you forget about the world entirely. That's what business people do. They're really bothered by all sorts of shock and panic, and you know, the business world is a really volatile world, and I go to the golf course and they'll sweat about, you know, golf for a while, and they for a while just your mind goes blank about the world. It really does. You forget all about it. You walk off the golf course and you don't even know there is a world, actually. And gradually you start to realize that the world's still there. You say, I didn't realize it was still there. So that's nice. But that's sort of a preliminary sort of thing. What we're doing here is much, 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 much more to the point and effective. Wow, my whole face is like burning. It's like tingling and burning. What is going on? That's amazing. Wow. The nose. Nosy. Don't get nosy. It's just like I'm getting nosy. Or the nosiness is leaving. One of the two. Let it leave. Wow, I'm having a tremendous reaction on my whole face. The nose is burning and tingling and itching, and there's some tremendous reaction going on. Wow. It's getting even stronger. Hands to hands, okay? Don't go scratching anything. Now, don't being nosy has to do with the world too. Don't be nosy as far as what's taking place in the world. Okay, don't try to dig into what's taking place in the world. So I have to keep reminding myself that. Don't be nosy about the world. I don't know what's going on. I have no idea. I don't have any answers of where this ancient groove came from. I can't link it to what's going on in the world. People ask you, well, it must have something to do with what's going on in the world. So I don't have a clue what's going on in the world, and so I don't have a clue where this came from, and I really can't speculate at all. Summertime is going to hit. The last 2 days it's gotten us ready, but tomorrow is supposed to hit, and then Saturday really hit hard, then Sunday really strong, then Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday. Strong, 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 strong. Feel the heat. We're going to feel the heat. So this summer is already blazing away now. We're into it. And as I said, this is a very significant summer. And no doubt it is. No doubt it is. The new way kicked it off May 22nd. May 22nd. I did what I was supposed to do to prepare for the new way, and so it was able to get kicked off here, and we're already well into it, actually. How about that? Congratulations, everyone. And we're talking about this ancient groove and how to prepare and how not to dig into it and not be nosy about it. How to on faith feel like for sure this is going to happen, therefore I really have to get ready for it. I really have to get ready for it. I really have to prepare to wow it instead of dig into it. Just wow it. Wow. I expected this to occur. Wow. I have no answers. Wow. I don't know anything. Wow. I don't have a clue. Wow. There's nothing I can do about it. Wow. I don't need to do anything. Wow. It just is. Wow. I can't really tell anything about it. Wow. I don't have any discernment about it. Wow. I'm clueless about it. Wow. No, I'm really clueless about it. Wow. So just stick with that. So definitely feeling reaction from this. This is very profound. So we need to expect the profound, but really, the profound is such that there's nothing we can even say about it. It's there, but there's nothing we can say about it. I can't say anything about it. I can't discern anything about it. I just draw a blank about it. It just, as far as discernment, just there's a blank there, just absolutely blank. I'm absolutely blank. I don't have a clue. I'll never have a clue about it. I really never will never have a clue about it. There'll never be anything I can say about it. There will never be anything I can say about it. The I can say about it. The I presumes concatenation, chain of causation, which is abnormality. So there's nothing that presumed abnormality can say about normality, because really there is no abnormality. So how can the abnormal comment on normality when there's only normality? It's not possible, actually. But we presume that it is. So for now, we'll say, well, I just don't, there's nothing I can say about it. I just cannot discern any context at all. Wow. I can't discern any context at all. Wow. I don't see anything to judge about it at all. It just seems to preclude any judgment whatsoever. Wow. And they say, people say, well, you're going to lose your judgment. Well, it's just there's nothing about this that it precludes judgment entirely here. And yet, if even since I can't judge it at all, but it remains, so it doesn't seem to have any adverse effect. About the fact that I can't judge it, doesn't seem to have any adverse effect on it at all. So it seems to inherently preclude judgment in itself. So it'd be kind of absurd it'd be very absurd to be concerned from that angle, really. That people will try to find something to be concerned about, of course. But what we practice is, I can never be concerned about anything. I can never be concerned about anything. I'm incapable of being of concern. Wow, I'm incapable of concern. I can never be concerned about anything at all. I can be aware of everything, but I can't be concerned about anything. So if there's awareness that someone needs help, you're aware and they do what needs to be helped, but you can't be concerned, you don't have any concern about it. You have awareness about it. You don't need any discernment, you have awareness about it. So, anyway, I can't discern anything at all. I can't discern anything at all about this. I'll never see any context. Well, I'm incapable of seeing context. I'm incapable of seeing any context. I was resting this afternoon, very tired, and a fly woke me up, buzzing. Like, where did you come from? I don't know how it got in. The room was closed. It wasn't in there before. It's pretty hard to understand how that fly got in. But it woke me up. I got up and did something. Oh, I looked at the U.S. Open results. It's funny. Talk about precognition. A friend of mine asked me today, he said, you know what? I said, the U.S. Open's on today. I asked him, how's it going? He said, I have no clue. I haven't looked. And I hadn't looked. I had no clue at all. And he said, I got a dark horse. I got a dark horse for this U.S. Open. Guess who it is? I said, guess who it is? Huh, who's your dark horse? I said, well, the guy I think is going to win it is Ricky Fowler. Now, I say Ricky Fowler, one, because he's been playing really well. Two, because he uses Cobra clubs, which are my clubs. So he's the spokesperson for Puma Golf, which is, they make Cobra golf clubs, which are really good golf clubs. And so he's the guy. So I want Ricky Fowler to win. So I said, Ricky Fowler. I feel like, you know, he's ready to win a U.S. Open. He really is. So that fly buzzed me. I said, oh, I want to check the U.S. Open. And I checked, and it was finished for the day. And lo and behold, at the top of the leaderboard, we're at 7-under, which ties an all-time record for the first round of the U.S. Open, is Ricky Fowler. And I said, holy cow, isn't that amazing? Extraordinary. Now, no one will believe that I didn't look at it, you know. But when he asked me that question, it was the middle of the day, so how would I know? But I didn't know at all. I just popped into my mind, Ricky Fowler. I hope he wins. Go Cobra. Cobra Golf. And the fact is the top four players in the world are a combined, I think, like 21 over par or something like that. 21 over par, the top four players in the world. And he's 7 under par. It's extraordinary. The top players are just getting annihilated out there. Jason Day, Rory McIlroy, Hideo Matsuyama or something like that, and Dustin Johnson. They're all way over par. Way over par. Jordan Spieth also, he's not on the top four, but he's also back way over par. It's something, I don't know what he is, but maybe he's just one over. None of the good players are doing well at all, except Ricky Fowler. He's the only one. It's got to be the clubs, you know? It's got to be the clubs, right? Can't be the Indian. It's got to be the arrow. But people think that, oh, he's not using Titleist or Callaway or TaylorMade, that, you know, he's somehow handicapped by his clubs, Cobra clubs. No. Cobra's making some of the best equipment in the world right now. No doubt about it. And those who have tested it out, professionals, and they do a lot of reviews, and they've said, you know, this equipment is just as good as the top equipment of any other company. Actually, it's really, really, really good stuff. So maybe he'll win and give the company a boost. You know, say, look, I'm using these clubs. It's good stuff, and it's cheaper. It's cheaper, which is what sold me. Yeah, I said, I can't afford these other clubs. I like TaylorMade. Are you kidding me? And I got, you know, a club that a couple years old. It was new, but it was still a couple years old, and they don't make it anymore. So I got a really great, great discount from Cobra. But I know, I said, this is a heck of a really, really good club. No doubt about it. And pros testing the two, doing the best TaylorMade and Cobras. And he said, well, you know, they're very comparable. Very, very comparable. I can't say one's better than the other. He said, I'm going to stick with TaylorMade because it's adjustable in the sole, you know, and I'm used to it. And I said, but, he says, if you use the Cobra, you're not deficient in your equipment at all. No way are you deficient. That's a good feeling to know. It's great to see Fowler doing great with these clubs. It gives me a lot of confidence. Say, hey, you know, I can use these clubs, and I'm not being shortchanged in the equipment category at all, although he has the newest version of everything. Of course, they keep making new stuff. Every manufacturer does it, you know, every year. Although TaylorMade like 4 times a year, basically. Everyone wants to get an edge, and business people always want to get an edge over their competition. So they're always thinking, how could I get an edge? So TaylorMade says, well, I got this new club. Really? Yeah, it's got this and this and this and this, and your buddies, they don't have it. So you've got a little edge over them. And so business people say, yeah, I'll take any edge I can get. Always looking for some edge. So they're able to, you know, the golf is driven by those business people who buy. And it never stops. And people like me, it doesn't matter. You know, just so it's up there, I'm not being, you know, shortchanged in a large measure, that's fine. As long as it's, you know, quality, I'll take something that's a couple years old. Nobody's buying it anymore. That's fine. Feels great. I love it. I love the way it feels. I'm saying, like, yeah, this is suitable for me. It's suitable for me. It's not, you know, the most noticeable big shot brand, but it's actually just as good as the big shot brands, if not better. But it doesn't have the, you know, snob appeal of any of that stuff. And of course, Ricky Fowler's a Californian from Sacramento, or near Sacramento. So go Ricky. We actually watched him at a tournament, and I said, and we really liked him. I said, man, that guy, I hope he's great. And just his attitude, everything. He's a Californian. He's got this wonderful attitude, and we hope that he goes on and wins. And he's one of the top golfers in the world. There's no question about it. Maybe this is his breakthrough time. Hope so. Hope it's our breakthrough time, right? Definitely. Are indefinitely. I can never define what this groove is. There's no way I can define what this groove is. Practice that. There's no way I can define what this groove is. You know, it is, but I can't say how it is or where it is or what it is or anything. I really don't have any description or definition of it at all. I can't describe it. I can't define it. It just is. Hope there's no mosquitoes. I mean, they're around. They're around. I hope it gets too hot for them. That's the only consolation. If it can it get too hot for mosquitoes? Probably if you're in the desert Southwest for the next week, it's probably too hot for the mosquitoes. As someone told me, looked at their, it's like Arizona, 120, 121, you know, coming up. Okay. Yeah. I'd love to experience that. That'd be quite a nice experience. Probably teach you to sit quiet and do nothing. It's a great excuse to do nothing. Super hot weather, right? Of course, problem is, you can sit in an AC house and eat. Eat ice cream. That's a problem. Since you're not doing any exercise, hot weather can lead to weight gains. It absolutely can. You see people who come from descendants of cold weather people, and it seems like they're always thin. Maybe they didn't have a lot to eat, but they're active. They need to stay warm. You don't stay warm by doing nothing. They're active people, and they're thin and active. But if you live in a super hot climate, I can see how you might get fat. And I just want to sit here quietly and might meditate, but I also want to eat. But I'm not burning calories. It's too hot. Are you kidding me? How can you burn calories? It's 120. Well, you get in a cold pool and swim is what you do. That's how you. In Arizona, it seems like everybody has a swimming pool. Pretty nice place. And they get in the pool. It's amazing. There's such a swim culture there. It's just that's the culture. You got to do it. If you want to exercise, it's the pool or nothing, basically. So people splash around and swim in the pool. There's a tremendous cool pool culture. Even, you know, it's too hot to play golf, 120. Right, you do that in the rest of the year, but the summertime they're in the pool. Not a bad culture. I would love that kind of culture. Unfortunately, I've never lived in that kind of culture, but I'd love to. You know, there's something it feels beautiful, but who knows, right? Wow. I can't say anything about anything. Wow. I really can't say anything. I really can't figure anything out. There's nothing that I can figure out. I'm incapable of figuring anything out. Just keep seeing your eye like that. Expect the eye to be like that. It's just, I'm just drawing a blank. I'm just totally drawing a blank. All I can do is draw a blank. Wow. All I can do is draw a blank. Wow. All I can do is draw a blank. Wow. I used to do all sorts of very creative stuff with video feedback. I got these old monitors and television sets that actually had feedback. And then hooked video cameras up. I did all sorts of very creative stuff. I can't remember how I did it, but I experimented for years. And I really was able to record some stuff that it was so amazing that even if you saw it today, you would see that it's just absolutely amazing. These patterns that form, these mandalas that form with video feedback on these old monitors. The new ones don't work. And I had an old video camera, too, that was analog, sort of a solid state, but it was really old. I had really old equipment, and you could get this spectacular by adjusting the coloration and exposure and everything of the old TVs. It was all manual adjustments. You could just get these swirling energy particles of light that turned into form mandalas, a gorgeous, beautiful mandalas. I did a lot of recording of that, and then I did also some other types of stuff. I did a video called Summer in Sumeria. And it was like some ancient land where all these light forms that looked like sort of like buildings but weren't quite buildings, sort of like landforms that weren't landforms. It was so abstract. It was so beautiful. You know, it was just achingly beautiful. It was just mind-blowingly beautiful. I may have had a video of it, Summer in Samaria. Unfortunately, I threw all those videos away. But it was really fortunate, because otherwise I probably would have gotten stranded in trying to represent this ancient groove. You know, and really there's nothing I can do to represent it. I can't represent anything practicing that. I can't represent anything at all. I can't represent anything. I'm incapable of any sort of representation. I have no capacity to represent at all. So it was necessary to go beyond creativity that we're used to reach, to allow some ancient groove to arise that is ultimately, you know, way superior. But I did have that experience of doing those videos, which was just, at that time, was just shocking. You know, it was so advanced in its beauty. Even today, it would seem to be extraordinarily beautiful. But, you know, who knows? It might have been famous for it. It might have, you know, people just say, "Oh, wow, you've got this," and then you'd be stuck in thinking that, you know, you have a technique and all this stuff, and you can do this, and this is what you represent as, and da-da. Where here we say, I can't represent as anything at all. I don't have any technique. I'm incapable of any technique. I'm incapable of any totally incapable of any technique. So in the long run, it turned about to be a blessing, but it was a very tough decision, because I felt like I was throwing, you know, any chance at making something out of my life, you know, the creativity I was capable of. I felt that this is going to, it was like almost inimitable. We could not imitate it. Nobody has ever done anything like it, apparently. I've never seen anything like it. It was just, I stumbled upon it in certain ways, and I really experimented with it to a great extent. And I had like one monitor feeding into another monitor, and one camera providing feedback on one monitor, and then another camera taping the second monitor, which was getting feedback from the first monitor, which had feedback from the first camera, and various arrangements and tweaking everything, and it was just, I was able to just do amazing stuff. But now I'm saying I can't do anything at all. I can't do anything at all. So whatever is will just have to be it, because I can't do anything at all. So this is clearly vastly more advanced. But it wasn't easy to get here. I had to let go of my creativity in order to do this, at least the creativity that we associate, normally call creativity. I've had to let go of it for the most part. I'm trying not to be as drastic as I was before and threw it all away. Yeah, I might have kept one copy of all of each one just for, you know, just for nostalgia purposes. But then, of course, I would have gotten into it and duplicated them, and it would have been a different destiny if I hadn't thrown them all away. I threw them all in a dumpster. Hundreds and hundreds. I duplicated them. I had many copies, you know, hundreds of copies of all these 55 videos I made, and I threw them all away. Thousands of videos away. Just put them all in a dumpster, and that was pretty rough. And so I've done many times, I've sort of just thrown everything away. And you know, that's it. Even the world, I said today, there's no world. I can't see a world at all. For me, there's no world. There'll never be any world. For me, there will never be any world. And I'm letting go of this world. I let go of this world. There's nothing I can do. There is no world. There is no world. I can't discern any world at all. I can't discern any world at all. So that's a very super great practice as well. I can't discern any world at all. But I do see a lot of bugs moving here and there. There's no lack of bugs. It's amazing, the swimming pool. I saw the whole surface was like covered with bugs. It's like thousands upon thousands upon thousands. It's like, I guess they came to get a drink, and they certainly got a drink. Maybe they came for immersion. They said, yeah, I'm going to die anyway. I'm a bug, and my lifespan's 2 days. I might as well immerse myself in this beautiful pool. So maybe they were just digging the light in the pool, and they said, ah, and they just expanded into the light, you know, and left their little form behind. Who are we to say, right? I mean, what is the life of a bug, and how does it really, how does their come to an end, actually? It's so ephemeral, right? Maybe it's very the light. It's just the light saying, I don't want to have much to do with form. I think I'm going to just to realize I'm just light, no structure. I'm a bug for a moment. And all these birds flying around catching the bugs in the morning. Bug catchers. I thought they were bats, but I don't think they were bats. They certainly acted like bats, but I couldn't discern whether they're bats or not. Early morning, it could have been bats, but I think, I'm not sure, but it could have been these birds who I saw fly, and they can just change, change angles like really fast, and they're just catching bug, bug, bug. And there's a lot of big bugs flying around. So they see a bug that they're just flying around there, and they see a big, bug going along. They swoop, suddenly change direction very quickly. But certainly bats can do that also. But they're just out there feasting. And yeah, there's just a massive amount of bugs. Amazing how many bugs there are, huh? So I can't say anything at all about it. People say, "Well, can't you say anything about it? I mean, we've got to get some definition going." I say, "I really can't define it at all. I don't have any definition at all. I mean, really, I feel incapable of any sort of definition. I'm not capable of any definition. I can't really say anything at all about it. There's really nothing I can say about it." Practice saying that. Practice what I'm saying. Practice it. So when I say this, I'm saying it to practice it. There's nothing I can say at all about it. It's not a secret. It's wide open, but there's really nothing. I'm incapable of any sort of discernment. I don't see any context at all. I don't see any context at all. I can't see any context. My face has calmed down to a certain extent here. So practice not being nosy. Don't dig, don't dig. Generally, I don't dig into anything, anyone's business at all. I can't tell you what's going on with this person or that person or anyone. I say, it's their business, their life. I'm not going to dig into it. So I don't tend not to be nosy. I don't even dig what's going on in the world. Not nosy about the world at this moment. Just whatever's going on. What world? Me, I don't. There isn't even a world at all, so there's really nothing to dig into. I don't even see anything to dig into. So say wow to this. Say wow to your practice. Say wow to your day. And let it be that way. And practice this. Practice, 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 practice. And you have to. It has to advance you. It has to, tremendously, actually. But just don't. Don't get bummed out if it doesn't happen right away. Well, it still hasn't happened for me, after all this work. But it certainly feels a lot closer. I mean, we're certainly really right into it, in terms of close to it, you might say, and able to practice in this way. That certainly sets the stage, so the staging is way better set for it. Who knows, right? If you set the stage in the right way, maybe the singer will appear, or the truly great singer will appear. So I decided not to sing so I can listen to the great singer. And what I understand, recognize is, in so doing, I'll be a vastly better singer than if I tried to sing right now. It's really not a good time to try and sing right now. Try to interact with the world in a creative way. It's the wrong time for that. It's the right time for presence, actually. The wrong time for entertainment and creativity, because the world is desperate for it, but it wants to determine the context, okay? It says, yeah, sing for us, but here's the context. And they'll set the context for you. So I said, no deal, no way, no how, okay? Because what we have to do is we have to shift the context into spontaneity. That's where we're headed, is spontaneity. That's what we are. What we are, we're spontaneous. We're not spontaneous this or spontaneous that. We're this absolutely free spontaneity, creative spontaneity. That's what we really are. And it's in all directions, simultaneously, constantly, each moment, as this never-ending flow. There's nowhere where our creativity is not, actually. There's no way that it's not. There's no way that it's not. So this video is hit me hard, really. I can feel it. So we're really stirring it up and taking a look where we really haven't looked before, about how to practice in a way that we can feel it's super effective. It's like we're setting the stage and you kind of feel like, wow, I really feel like we've pretty much set the stage in the right way. And it's time for the great singer to suddenly, out of the blue, there's the singer. There's Ronnie Hinson, you know, singing, so to speak. I was listening to Ronnie Hinson last night. Wow. I think great has to be used to describe him. When he reached his peak, I wasn't 86, I think, 1986 maybe. He really peaked. Unfortunately, died young. Very unfortunate. Otherwise, he would have gone on, I mean, to be recognized as one of the greatest singers ever, for sure. But there are several songs, when he's at his peak, I just say, wow. Now that is superior singing. That just is, you know, in class by itself up there, really. So listening to a great singer, a really great singer, that's like very profound. You say, wow, I didn't know that we expressive creativeness could be like that. Opens up a new vista. Well, if we allow the great singer, which is really the one self, we allow ourselves to listen to that, what can we say? I can't say anything at all. There's no gap in where words can even enter. The simultaneous instantaneousness in all directions, the spontaneous instantaneousness in all directions, just flowing with this spontaneous creativity, there's no gap anywhere. There's no gap. So where do we start defining? Where do we put words? Where do we start with words? There's no place. I can't even get started with words at all. I can't even get started with words at all. Therefore, Rama Harshi, silence. Rama Maharshi, silence, silence. It's just there's nowhere to start. There's no, where do you start? There isn't some gap where your creativity is absent. No, the creativity is in full flower everywhere. And it continues. So where do you stop to try and apply some label to this? It's ridiculous. That would be utterly ludicrous. So it's just, there isn't any way to even speak of it. There's no way to grasp it. There's no handles to it. Cannot be grasped. I can't grasp anything. I can't describe anything. I'm incapable of giving any description at all. I'm incapable of grasping anything. I'm totally incapable of grasping anything. So this kind of practice prepares us for this ancient groove, quote unquote, right? Ancient groove. This ancient groove. And we just can't say really anything about it at all. I can't say anything about anything at all. I can't say anything at all. There's nothing I can say. I can't say anything at all. I'm incapable of saying anything at all. Yeah. It's staying pretty warm this evening, so I can tell tomorrow's going to heat up. They say that that high pressure creates heat. That's pretty interesting. Because really, what causes heat, I think, is a huge cold air mass gets trapped at high elevations, gets pushed up to high elevations, and then it stops moving. And what happens is cold air is heavier than hot air. So cold air has this, we call it high pressure effect, whereas hot air rising, it has a low barometric pressure. What happens, though, is this cold air starts falling, and the faster it goes, the more it heats up. See, air falling, air in motion tends to heat up, especially when it's falling apparently down towards the earth. It heats up. And so when you have a massive amount of high pressure air falling, which it does when it's heavier than the other air, so it falls, the friction that takes place as it's falling from great distances, I believe that heats the air up. This is what happens. It heats up. The air actually heats up through atmospheric friction. It's not the sun so much that's heating the air. It's atmospheric friction that's heating the air. And then as it falls, it tends to push offshore. It tends to, you know, hit the ground and causes, like Santa Ana winds, offshore winds that go out towards the ocean and pushes the fog away. It's like you have a high pressure system like that. High pressure system in charge, where somehow this air it seems to be, to me, that it's falling. And they say that winds are like when they're racing over the mountains, winds being pushed over mountain, it heats up. Also, the Santa Ana winds in California are an example. You have these winds that as they're going over the landscapes and mountains being pushed this way, it really heats them up, become very hot winds. The Sirocco, I think, in North Africa or something, a hot wind. Winds can get hot because if the large air mass is in motion, turbulence and friction of that really heats the air up. So that's what's apparently there's a huge high pressure system. I think the whole United States is under high pressure, interestingly enough. A kind of fits the mood of the country, doesn't it? Doesn't it? Yeah. I think the whole country's in like a heat wave. I'm not sure. I haven't dug into it at all. I did see one blurb like Northeast heat wave, and that's all. I just then on you know, I said I'm not gonna look, I'm not gonna dig into it. But people's tempers could be fraying, couldn't they? You get massive heat waves this summer, and we don't know what's going to spark. You know, out of the blue, I said, out of the blue, something could spark. You know, it's usually some, you know, claim of police atrocities or something is enough to start sparking riots in one city. And before you know it, there's riots in every city, and then you know they call the police out to stop it, and there's even more riots over that. And before you know it, there's, you know, civil disobedience, and before you know it, you have a, you know, a riotous summer. And he calls for, you know, revolution and overthrow of the government, and you know, we're ripe for that. The country's ripe for that. They've gotten so used to being belligerent towards authority that they're ripe to just say, you know what, let's just junk all authority and have it the way we want it. And then demagogues arise to pander to that attitude, of course, and they say, yeah, I'm with you. You know, just make me your leader, and I'm down with the people. I'm a people's person. I'm down with that people's power, and make sure that you get what you want, and just put me in power. You know, there's all these people, demagogues who, you know, jump out of the woodwork. They've been waiting for this time, for sure. But for us, we anticipate that we're headed in that direction. Certainly the United States is, probably Europe is, probably a lot of countries are in the world, to really clashes and turmoil. So, and the turmoil could spread between countries, etc., etc. So what we want is this groove. We want to be this groove to just arise. And we're just inexplicably in this groove. Inexplicably. No explanation. I have no explanation for it. But I'm in it. See, we want that. We've aimed for that. I've definitely, specifically aimed for that. Right for this summer. I don't know its name. I don't know where it came from. I don't know its characteristics. I don't know anything at all. I don't know anything at all. So get used to that being your perspective on what you're experiencing. I don't know anything at all about what I'm experiencing. I don't know anything at all about what I'm experiencing. I'll never know anything at all about what I'm experiencing. I'll never know anything, I mean, definableness about it at all. I'll never know anything about what I'm experiencing. Get used to feeling that way. That's okay. I expect that. I expect not to know anything at all about what I'm experiencing. See, once you feel comfortable, say, oh, that's what I expect. Then it can arise, and you'll say, oh, I'm not going to go into panic at all. Nothing to panic about. Others might say, well, if I experience that, I panic. Well, that's why you're not experiencing it. But for me, I train myself not to panic, so that's why, you know, I'm experiencing, because I'm not panicking about it. I can't explain it at all. I don't know what I'm experiencing at all. All right. This is very auspicious to say the least. Thank you, Holy Spirit, grace of God, inner guru, and outer gurus as well. And all of you for being willing to hear this and hopefully practice it. Even a little bit of practice, you'll build your confidence. But if you can really see what we're getting at here, you might have an aha moment and say, aha, Now I really see very clearly. Yeah, it's very doable, isn't it? That there's total wisdom to this. It's how you prepare for what we're preparing for, right? It's just without faith, you won't prepare in this way. With faith, you can prepare in this way. Those who lack faith will never prepare in this way. Absolutely not. They'll think it leads to insanity. But those who have faith in this absolutely numinous groove that we just can't say anything at all about, we absolutely can prepare in this way, and it makes it's very reasonable it to us, absolutely reasonable to us. We can see, ah, of course, obviously, this is how you prepare. Wow. So I highly recommend preparing for those who feel their life is going to be tremendously auspicious. I highly recommend preparing right now in this way, because this summer could very well kick off a very the world is not going to be the same. Let's put it that way. It's not going to be the same going forward. Not what we're used to, not what we expect, not, you know, it's going to be something. Yeah, as they said in the 60s, people in motion. For those who come to San Francisco, you know, people in motion, people in motion. Yeah, because everybody seemed to be in motion, and there's this restlessness and seeking, and you know, just like a disturbed ant colony. You know, just everything's just moving around, moving around, moving around, moving around, kind of aimlessly, just, you know, wandering aimlessly, thinking that it's some aim purposefulness to their aimlessness. It could get very distracted, as if distraction is the new groove of the world. We don't know what the groove of the world is going to be exactly in terms of the egoic groove, but it's likely to get very strong, and you don't want to be grooved in that way. So we need to be grooved in the other way, right? And we grooved in such a way we can't say anything about it. We can't explain it at all. No way we can explain it. It's inexplicable. Out of the blue, inexplicable. Out of the blue, inexplicable. Wow. But see, it feeling very appropriate to this times that we're in now. Very appropriate. Like a panacea, like an antidote, like the perfect antidote, the perfect panacea. And yet we can't. It's inexplicable. Totally inexplicable. I can't explain it at all. It's totally inexplicable. I can't explain it at all. It's totally inexplicable. I can't explain it at all. It's totally inexplicable. I can't explain it at all. It's totally inexplicable. I can't explain it at all. It's totally inexplicable. I can't explain it at all. It's totally inexplicable. And yet, you know, I'm stable. I'm stable. I'm not panicking. Stable. I'm not panicking. Stable. I'm not panicking. Because I'm wow. I'm in the wow. This is wow. It's inexplicable. Wow. This ancient groove is totally inexplicable. Wow. Out of the blue. Wow. I have no explanation for it in any direction. Wow. I can't even hazard any a guess in any direction. Wow. I can't even hazard any guess in any direction. Wow. I'm incapable of even guessing in any direction. Wow. Not even the slightest speculation. Wow. I'm incapable of even the slightest speculation. Wow. I'm incapable of even the slightest speculation. Wow. Now I have to sleep tonight with that. So this is very profound, to say the least. I'm totally incapable of any, even the slightest speculation. Wow. That hit really hard. There's no water out here. I forgot to bring my water. So I know I would need it, but what is this? It's a spider's attached itself. There's so many little spiders out here. I realize, ah, there's one right there, you know. Okay. But, yeah, no water out here. It's a good excuse to go inside. Good excuse to go inside. So I would say, even if a little spider appears, I should have just said, okay, forget it. I'm in the wow. So I tried to distract myself there. So just, no distractions, just wow. Totally incapable of even the slightest speculation in any form whatsoever. Now there's the burn. That's what you're really looking for, this burn. You feel sort of this burn in deep down. And your nerves, it just burn. It's like, wow. It's a meltdown of expectation. I'm totally incapable of even the slightest speculation in any direction. Totally incapable of even the tiniest speculation in any context whatsoever. So say this and believe it with faith that this is so for you. And then your expectations will react like mine are reacting now. Causing a tremendous commotion among my deep expectations. Like an inner earthquake. But I say, wow, okay, wow. I know my superficial functioning will be fine, okay? So, no trouble, just wow. Very intense burn. I'm incapable of even the slightest speculation on anything. I'm incapable of even the slightest speculation on anything. So you can feel when you've really got to something, and we certainly have here. I don't feel like saying anything at all. I might say, I can't say anything at all. I really cannot say anything at all. I cannot speculate even in the slightest way in any direction, in any context whatsoever. Incapable of even the slightest speculation in any regard. So from a spiritual standpoint, this feels like bringing the hammer down. Really brought the hammer down here. So I'm just full stop in the wow. I'm not looking at the reaction, it's there. But instead I'm just looking at the wow. I say, okay, my response to this is wow. As I feel is wow. So that's the security blanket. Wow is like a security blanket. As soon as we have the wow, we say everything's fine, no problem. You know, like a little kid, they're scared by something and nothing will calm them down, but you give them that security blanket and I'm safe now. I'm safe. So the wow is like that security blanket for a little kid. It immediately calms us down. So, there's no way this is going to, this the wow is going to come to an end. And really, this is very powerful. So, I just have to stay in the wow and let it sink in. And some point, go to sleep, or at least lie down and go to sleep. But I'll stay awake for a while. Maybe I'll make a smoothie or something, a nice cold smoothie, and I just kick back. But I could sit here quietly for a long time. So remember, also, don't do anything. Don't think about doing anything. Just sitting here. You don't have to do anything. That's why yogis in caves are so helpful. I mean, they're there in a cave, and there's nothing calling upon them to do anything at all. Sometime taping in the middle of the night might be a good idea, right? And just be silent for hours. Maybe I can do that. The warm night's coming up, right? Yeah. So the intensity has dropped just a little bit. It's still there. It's like a fire. It's not in its full blaze, but it's dropped a little bit down from the full blaze intensity. So you might want to sit for even longer until it drops even more, and some maybe all the way till just the coals are there. Yeah, but and you can do so. Some videos I make are 3 hours, and maybe I will just, you know, go on and just talk. I might even do it now in terms of just kind of talking about stuff and just sort of not even doing anything. Don't rush into doing anything. It's really important when you really hit that burn like we just did. It's very important to not really try to do anything or even interact in any way. That's why I try not to plan my life at all, because then this allows this to take place like this. Whereas if you have a plan for tomorrow, I wouldn't have gone into this. I say, no, I got to make sure I can function well tomorrow, so I'm not going to risk this. So really, when anyone tries to ask me, what are you going to do for the weekend? I say, I don't know. I really don't have any plans yet. And I don't have any plans yet. I don't know what I'm going to do. Because to try and plan when you feel like this, it will short circuit the whole thing. So really, this weekend, I actually have one more day. It's not, we haven't reached it yet. I have to work tomorrow. Is what I have to do. Son of a gun. Okay, so I do know what I have to do, but I'm not sure what I have to do at work. I really don't know. Maybe it won't be any. Might be a little bit, but who knows? I'm not going to pin that down. It's. I never know. But this is an extremely strong reaction of going past expectations like this. So I don't feel like hardly moving or doing anything. Classic example of the power or success of this technique. Now, I could do anything, but I just don't feel like it. You know, it's like I'd rather just sit here. We could use a breeze here. The breeze has stopped. If there was a breeze now, it'd be perfect. Don't place any expectations upon yourself. When you feel like this, don't place any expectations. Just remain. Say, well, I'm not going to really do anything, including plan for the future, plan what to expect, how do I meet expectations of this and this and this. Like if you work out, you know, it's good not to have expectations of what you're going to do tomorrow. You may not feel like it tomorrow. You don't know how you're going to feel if you, you know, really do a great workout. You may wake up just like, ah, I can hardly move. So, or you may wake up and say, I feel pretty good. It's really kind of hard to tell sometimes, right? You don't know. So I don't know how I'm going to feel. So I'm not going to plan any sort of future strategy at all. No strategy. So what I'm going to do is just stay in the wow. I just relax. I realize, okay, tomorrow what I'm going to do, I'm just going to stay in the wow. That's what I expect. I'll have the wow with me all day. So I know exactly what to expect. I will stay in the wow. And suddenly I totally relaxed there. And now I feel like, okay, I'm functional again. Amazing. I'm not worried. I was thinking about the, how am I going to function tomorrow? And I said, what do you mean? I already know. I'll just function in the wow. I'll just be wowed all day. I'll just spend all day just being wowed. So I already know that's my plan. So it's continuity with right now, you know, same, wow. Absolutely, no problem at all. That's what I will do. I will experience the wow. That's my doing for the day. How are we doing here? 2 hours, yeah, well. Wow. Amazing. That's how you want it to go. So, very auspicious. Very, very auspicious video. Wow. And so just stay in the wow of that, and then you'll be at ease. You won't be panicky. Say, oh, no, I'm able to function just fine. I know exactly what to expect, and that is, I'll feel wow. Okay. Just go with that. It's like a panacea. It's amazing. As soon as that came into my mind, I accepted it, and my entire psyche just relaxed. I said, "Yep, I can go forward another day, right? I can go forward now. I can function. I'm okay. Very great." So just wow.